Knee joint being the largest synovial joint in the body, therefore it is clinically also the most important joint. So in this video, we are going to discuss the basics of the anatomy of the knee joint. Welcome everyone, myself Dr. Ankit Khandelwal, MBBS and MS in anatomy. This is my YouTube channel, Anatomy Explained. So if you like the video, do like, share and subscribe to the channel. I have also a few Facebook pages and Telegram groups whose links are there in the description box below. So let's start the video, the anatomy of the knee joint. So these are the learning objectives under which we are going to discuss today's topic. First of all, because the topic is a little bigger, the type, that is knee joint is in which type. Then the ligaments, the bursa, the blood supply, the movements, and about locking and unlocking. So these are a few important learning objectives of the day. So let's start with the type of the joint. The knee joint, as we know, is the joint which moves. So therefore, it is coming under the synovial variety of the joint. In synovial variety, there are more than two bones involved, so we call it as a compound joint. Now, which bones are involved over here? The bones which are involved over here are our femur. Then we have a sesamoid bone, the largest sesamoid bone, patella, and we have tibia. So you have few areas over here, that is the joint between femur and patella. The joint between femur and patella comes under the saddle type of synovial joint. The joint between the two condyles of the femur and the two condyles of tibia, they come under the condylar, or we can say the bicondylar variety of synovial joint. And as patella being the largest sesamoid bone, with that one more largest word is appropriate for here, that this knee joint is the largest synovial joint. It is the largest synovial joint of the body, or we can just say largest joint of the body, being larger than the hip joint, being larger than the ankle, being larger than the even the shoulder joint. So it is a compound joint. It is always synovial variety, compound joint, largest joint. And functionally we say it is a modified hinge joint. Functionally it is also comes under a variety of the modified hinge joint. Now what happens over here? That hinge joint, they normally moves in one axis only, that is the flexion and extension. So the basic movement in the knee joint is our flexion and extension, but as it is modified and being the largest joint, then there's a little bit of rotation also involved apart from our flexion and extension of the joint. So rotation involved both the medial as well as the lateral rotation. So to understand, it is a compound complex joint. Okay, also we can include a word over here, that is, it is a complex joint. Why? Because between the condyles of femur and tibia, we have arrangement of articular cartilages. Those are our fibrocartilages, which acts as a cushion to the knee joint. So wherever you have the articular cartilages involved, we try to classify that joint as a complex variety. So therefore, in a nutshell, knee joint is obviously synovial variety because it moves, but is a compound complex modified hinge joint variety of joint. So that is the type of the joint, that is our knee joint. Moving from the type of joint, we have the ligaments. Now the question comes over here, as it is the largest joint in the body, so it has to be supported by various structures, because when we walk, when we run, whole of the weight of our body is falling on these joints. So therefore, there are various ligaments which are covering the joint both externally and internally. So let us see those ligaments. First of all, we have a large fibrous capsule which envelops the joint from all the sides. In that large fibrous capsule, it is strengthened anteriorly by the ligamentum patellae, or we can call it as a patellar ligament. On the sides, both the sides, because it is basically a hinge joint, so it has the capsule is thickened on both the sides. Both the sides means on the medial as well as the lateral side. So on both the sides, we have collateral ligaments. We have a pair of collateral ligaments, and these collateral ligaments are present medially as well as laterally. The medial, which bone we have in the leg, medial, we have the tibia bone in the leg, so medial collateral ligament is also known as tibial collateral ligament. The lateral collateral ligament is known as the fibular collateral ligament. Okay, so apart from this collateral ligaments, what we just said about the complex variety, we have articular cartilage that are known as meniscus, Again, these meniscus are present on the lateral as well as the medial side, known as the lateral and the medial meniscus. Apart from this meniscus, it also has a pair of cruciate ligaments. Now, these cruciate ligaments are actually crossing each other, but they are attached anteriorly and posteriorly in respect to tibia. So, when they are attached anteriorly posteriorly in respect to tibia, we call these cruciate ligaments as the anterior cruciate ligament and a posterior cruciate ligament. Okay, these are the cruciate ligaments. Apart from these ligaments, it has also a thickening of few muscles because the capsule has to be strengthened. Capsule is strengthened anteriorly by the patellar ligament, on both the sides by the collateral ligament. Okay, by posteriorly it will be strengthened by our oblique popliteal ligament. Oblique popliteal ligament, which is said to be a condensation or extension of semimembranosus muscle, which is actually a muscle of the hamstring compartment of the thigh. We also have an arcuate ligament. We also have an arcuate ligament. Now, this arcuate ligament strengthens the joint again from the posterior aspect, mainly the posterior lateral aspect. Apart from these meniscus, that is the lateral medial meniscus, as they reach anterior side, that they are connected anteriorly, we will see in the figure, by the transverse ligament. So it is this ligament, transverse ligament, which connects the anterior horns or anterior margins of both the medial as well as the lateral meniscus. So these are just a few ligaments which are actually surrounding the whole knee joint, making it stronger. Let us look into few details of these ligaments, to start with the collateral ligament. Now, as we go to the collateral ligaments, as I told you that basically knee joint is a hinge joint, so collateral ligaments are present on the sides. So we have a medial or a tibial CLS collateral ligament, and we have a lateral or a fibular CL is a collateral ligament. Now, if we look at the knee joint, then if we make the knee joint from anteriorly, this would be our femur. Okay, this would be the lower end of femur, and that would be the upper end of tibia. Okay, and this small bone over here would be the fibula. So I'm just writing T over here, F E dot over here for femur, F I dot over here for fibula. This, if you are looking the knee joint from the anteriorly, from the anterior aspect, okay, so this obviously would be the right knee joint. So this obviously would be our right knee joint from the anterior part. Now let us try to make these collateral ligaments. Collateral ligament one is present on the medial side, so this will be our medial collateral ligament. One is present on the lateral side, coming from the condyles of the femur going to the head of fibula. This would be our lateral collateral ligament or fibular collateral ligament. This would be our tibial collateral ligament. Fine. These are collateral ligaments. These are the thickenings of the capsule on the sides. So these are our collateral ligaments present on the sides. Now, one very important thing over here, I want to show it here only, that between this lower end of the femur and the upper end of tibia, or between the condyles of femur and condyles of tibia, we have a cushioning which is present over here. That cushioning is what? This is your meniscus. This cushioning is our meniscus. Okay, it is a cushioning, you'll see in the other view also, but it is present somewhat over here. So this obviously will be the medial meniscus, and this would be our lateral meniscus. Okay, now very important thing over here is that this tibial collateral or the medial collateral ligament is actually fused to the medial meniscus, while this lateral collateral ligament is actually separated from the lateral meniscus by a tendon over here, which is our popliteus tendon. So popliteus tendon is present laterally, which goes posteriorly because it is basically a muscle of the unlocking. So over here we have a tendon of popliteus, which is separating this lateral collateral from the lateral meniscus. Now, what is its clinical implication? Its clinical implication is very straightforward, and that is, in any injuries of the ligaments, because these ligaments are prone for injuries, because there are so many ligaments. In any injuries of the ligaments, if there is injury of the lateral collateral ligament, it normally does not involve lateral meniscus because it is not fused to the meniscus. So lateral collateral ligament injuries normally don't involve lateral meniscus. While on the other hand, the injuries of the medial collateral ligament, they may easily involve the medial meniscus. So that is one very important clinical importance. Apart from this, we also saw about the cruciate ligament. Now, cruciate ligaments are present like a cross over here. They will be present like a cross over here, anterior and a posterior cross, So this you'll see in the upper view or the superior view of the tibia. So these are the cruciate ligaments in the center. So these are the main ligaments, the collateral ligaments. Now, focusing mainly on the collateral ligaments over here, we had a lateral collateral and we had a medial collateral. Now, this picture being the anterior aspect of the right knee, then this side will be the lateral side and that side will be the medial side. Fine. Now, if there is, let me make it with this dark red color, if there is an abduction strain in this direction. So if someone is walking and there's something hitting someone, some vehicle or some motor or some anything hit the person from the outside, from the lateral side, this is known as the abduction strain. This will be known as the abduction strain. Now this abduction strain, if that is placed on the lateral part of the knee, it is mainly going to involve or go, it may rupture the medial collateral ligament. And with this medial collateral ligament, it could involve the medial meniscus, which is a common injury, which is not uncommon, which is a common injury. While on the other hand, if there is a adduction strain, so any strain from this side, that is, that will be our adduction strain. Any strain on this side, then it will involve the lateral collateral ligament if the strain is too much. Because if there's a force on this side, then obviously there will be stretching on the lateral collateral ligament. If there's a force from the abduction, that is the lateral side, there will be stretching of the medial collateral ligament. So therefore, which collateral ligament is prone for injury? It is always medial collateral ligament, which is much more prone for injury than the lateral collateral ligament. Point clear? So that was one very important point about the collateral ligament. Second, I told you that medial collateral ligament is sort of fused with the medial meniscus, so that is also involved. Moving from the collateral ligaments, let us see this figure now. In this figure, it is a coronal section taken. Now, focus on few points over here. First is the collateral ligaments, which we are just discussing. So, tibial collateral ligament over here and the fibular collateral ligament over here. You can see the tibial collateral ligament is fused with the medial meniscus at this point, while the fibular collateral ligament is separate from the lateral meniscus due to the popliteus tendon that we just discussed. And the center, we had the anterior and posterior cruciate ligament. This anterior posterior names are according to its attachment on the tibia. So it is named according to the tibial attachment over here, according to the tibial attachment over here. Okay, so look at how they are separating from each other. Other thing which we can appreciate from this diagram is that due to the menisci, we call it as a complex joint, but this meniscus actually divides the knee joint into two compartments. One between the meniscus and the femur, known as the meniscofemoral compartment, and one within the between the meniscus and the tibia, known as the meniscotibial compartment. Okay, so this is one thing over here about the collateral ligaments. Now moving from collateral ligaments, we come to the meniscal cartilages. These meniscal cartilages are our lateral menisci and the medial menisci and the medial menisci. So these are our two menisci. So few things we already discussed, that the medial menisci is the one which is actually fused with the tibial collateral ligament, while it is separated from the lateral collateral ligament by the tendon of popliteus, by the popliteus tendon. So that thing we have to keep in mind. Why? Because again, medial meniscus is much more prone from injury than the lateral meniscus. Medial meniscus is much more prone for injury than the lateral meniscus. Okay, medial meniscus, because the two condyles of femur and tibia, those two condyles are not symmetrical, therefore the shape of these menisci also differ. The medial meniscus is slightly more longer anterior posteriorly, and the lateral meniscus slightly more of a semicircle. So it's the shape is due to the difference of the shape of the condyles of the femur and tibia, that is the medial and the lateral meniscus. Okay, we other things also discuss over here. Let us see first the image. This is the image if you're looking at the superior surface of the tibia, of the tibial condyle, superior aspect of the tibial condyles, if you see, they appear like this. This is on the medial side, that is our medial meniscus. That is on the lateral side, that is the lateral meniscus. So these dots over here are representing your two meniscus. These are the cushions which are present over here. Fine, one thing is this. Second thing is, again, a clinical applied part. That clinical applied part is that these menisci, they are attached to the tibia mainly around their margins, peripheral margins. And this attachment of the menisci to the tibia is also given a name of a ligament that is known as your coronary ligament. Coronary ligament, we can also call it as a meniscotibial ligament. So that is point number one. Okay, so that is also another ligament known as coronary ligament. Now, second thing is that the peripheral part of the menisci, they are more vascular. The peripheral part of the menisci, they are what? They are more vascular. Therefore, if there is any injury on the peripheral part, that is known as the peripheral part or the vascular part, it can be easily sorted out surgically. It can easily be taken care of. But the inner part is basically the non-vascular part, or less vascular parts. Inner part is mainly if it is tear due to any tearing force, then the things become a little more complicated. So inner part is a less vascular part. Outer part of the meniscus are, both the meniscus are the more vascular part. Okay, that is point number one. The second point is, as this meniscus, they can see the shape also. The lateral meniscus is more of a semicircle or 4/5 of a circle. This medial meniscus is more anterior posteriorly. These both are anteriorly attached by a transverse ligament. So that could be asked as a question. Transverse ligament. Second thing is, these both of these menisci, they are attached on the intercondylar area. So this is the medial condyle of tibia, that is the tibial condyle of tibia. And this in the center part is known as the intercondylar area. These both menisci are attached with their anterior and the posterior horns into the intercondylar area. Then in this intercondylar area only, we have one more thing which are known as the attachment of the cruciate ligaments. You can see the anterior cruciate ligament is attached over here and the posterior cruciate ligament is attached over here. Now what happens is that this posterior horn of lateral meniscus, this one over here, as it goes, takes around a circle and attaches over here, this posterior horn of the lateral meniscus, it will send its fibers upwards to the femur. Goes superior to this, we have the femur. So it will send its fibers upward to the femur, anterior and posterior to the PCL. So you have a PCL attachment over here, anterior and posterior to it. The posterior horn of lateral meniscus sends its fibers above. What are these known as? These are known as your meniscofemoral ligament. So please note down one more thing, meniscofemoral ligament. They are coming from where? They are coming from the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. They are present where? They are present anterior and posterior to PCL, posterior cruciate ligament. Where will they attach? They will attach to the femur, obviously. And what are they known as? The anterior one is known as the ligament of Humphrey, and the posterior meniscofemoral ligament is known as the ligament of Ricberg. So that could also be a question, that this one over here would be known as the ligament of Humphrey, and this one over here would be known as the ligament of Ricberg. So these extensions of the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, they're actually going upwards into the femur. Where in the femur, they can ask you, they will attach where into the femur? They will mainly attach into the medial condyle of femur. What are they doing? They're actually supplementing, they're supporting the PCL more. So therefore the PCL, that is the posterior cruciate ligament, is much more stronger than the ACL, that is the anterior cruciate ligament. And for the same reason, again, the PCL is more easily ruptured, easily teared than the anterior cruciate ligament. Point clear? So these are a few things over here. About the cruciate ligament, we'll do it in a little more detail, but this was about the meniscus. So again, to the meniscus, two meniscus, like cushion. Peripheral part more vascular, so could be easily treated. Medial part or inner part is less vascular. Then from these two meniscofemoral ligaments, from the posterior horn of lateral meniscus, anterior and posterior to PCL, so they make PCL more stronger. These are the names Humphrey and Ricberg, and then where would they go into the femur? They would go into the medial condyle of femur. Okay, so this was your menisci acting as a cushion, due to which we call the joint as a complex joint. Moving from the meniscus, we reach into the cruciate ligament. We just saw the two cruciate ligaments and their names were anterior cruciate ligament and the posterior cruciate ligament. First of all, their names, as we have already discussed, their names are according to their attachment on the tibial intercondylar area. One which is attached more anterior, known as anterior. One which is attached more posterior, known as posterior. Now, why do we call it them as cruciate? Because they are crossing each other. So we call them as cruciate. Which is easily prone for tear or rupture? Anterior. So anterior cruciate ligament is more easily ruptured, than the posterior cruciate ligament, or vice versa. We can say that PCL is more stronger than ACL. PCL is more stronger than ACL. Okay, so this is one other point. Now, if they ask you about the dimensions, we can tell you the dimensions also. ACL, the length and breadth of ACL will be 38 mm/11 mm. Length is around 38 mm, breadth is around 11 mm. We talked about the dimension of PCL, the length is around 38 and the breadth is around 13 mm. So the 2 mm extra breadth is not a small thing pertaining to the knee joint. So this is our cruciate ligament. This is about a cruciate ligament. Now, how will they get tear? How will they get tear? For that, we have to understand few things. That if suppose this is say the femur over here, we are looking at a lateral view of the femur, and below we are seeing this as the tibia. Okay, below we are seeing this tibia. This is say the anterior aspect. There is a posterior aspect. You are looking at the lateral aspect of the knee joint. Okay, now this is the tibia. That is the femur over here. So obviously, if we are trying to make the cruciate ligaments, then which cruciate ligament would be this attached anteriorly to the tibia? That would be our anterior cruciate ligament. So what is the role of anterior cruciate ligament in the knee joint? Is that now try to imagine if someone is pushing the leg from behind. So this ACL prevents the anterior dislocation of tibia. It prevents the anterior DL of tibia, that is anterior dislocation of tibia. Or if someone is pushing the femur or thigh posteriorly, it is also preventing the posterior DL, posterior dislocation of the femur. So that is the role of ACL, anterior cruciate ligament. Now try to imagine that, okay, this was the role, but what if this got ruptured due to any injury? If this got ruptured due to any injury, what will happen? So if this got ruptured due to any injury, let me make it over here. Okay, now it will look at like a perfect injury. If this got ruptured, then the tibia could easily be dislocated anteriorly. So now it is not able to prevent the anterior dislocation tibia. So if the examiner puts his hands behind the leg and tries to pull the leg, then there would be a more mobility of the leg anteriorly. This is known as the anterior draw test. That is known as the anterior draw test, that is positive. In which cases? In cases of ACL rupture, a very common phenomenon, ACL rupture. Now we have to understand that this cruciate ligaments, ACL is normally tight during the extension of the knee. So when you extend the knee, this becomes tight. So any injury in the extension, any injury while rotation, that could easily rupture the ACL. So ACL is more easily ruptured during the hyperextension of the knee. And when it gets ruptured, the anterior draw test becomes positive. Okay, this was about the ACL. Now if you look at the PCL, that's counterpart of the PCL, it appears somewhat like this only. But again, this is the femur, that is the tibia, that is the anterior aspect, posterior aspect, F for femur, T for tibia. Then if we make the PCL, the PCL would be like this. Though it is more stronger, but yes, it is there. PCL would be like this. So what it is going to do? The PCL is going to prevent what? If someone is pushing the leg from anteriorly, so it is preventing the posterior dislocation of what? Posterior dislocation of the tibia, posterior dislocation of leg, oblique tibia. Okay, or someone is pushing the thigh from behind, then again it is preventing the anterior dislocation of the thigh or anterior dislocation of the femur. That is when ECL is stable working over there. But again, when it got ruptured or got teared, though not very common, but yes, in hyperflexion injuries, in rotation injuries of the knees, the PCL may get problematic over here, may rupture. And what happens is that if you now close the drawer, that is if the examiner now pushes the leg behind, then he will be able to feel more of the mobility of the leg posteriorly. So that is known as a posterior drawer test positive. Posterior drawer test positive. It's just like you open the drawer, you close the drawer. So if there is a drawer over here, and there's a handle of the drawer, if you're trying to open it, that is you are trying to pull the leg towards you. So that is an anterior drawer test. There's an anterior drawer test. In this case, PCL rupture, you are trying to close it. You feel extra mobility. That is a posterior draw test of the cruciate ligament. So that was your ACL and your PCL, the cruciate ligaments. Now, one more question that which come from these cruciate ligaments are that these cruciate ligaments, they are very important, very strong. These cruciate ligaments are present inside the capsule, so they are known as intracapsular ligament. But they are actually outside the synovial, so they are also known as extrasynovial. Please remember that also. They are outside the confines of the synovial, but they are inside the capsule. So they are intracapsular, extrasynovial. That was your cruciate ligament. Moving from cruciate ligament, now we come to the bursa. Bursa is a sac. Bursa is a sac which is filled with the synovial fluid. That is for the reducing the friction around the joints. So you can see the joints covered by the muscles and tendons. So obviously there will be more of friction in that. So bursa, various bursas present. Around 12 to 14 bursas are present around the knee joint. Not needed to know them all, but the important clinical ones. So important clinical ones are present mainly on the anterior aspect, present on the posterior aspect because you have a clinical situation over there, and present on the posterior medial aspect, that is around the pes and serenus. That is around the pes and serenus. So these are the few areas in which the bursas are important. Let us see how they are important. So this is the figure over here about the bursas. Bursas are sac filled with synovial. So this is your anterior area of the knee, that is the posterior area. It starts with simpler ones, the suprapatellar bursa. It goes above the patella. It is attached above to a muscle, that is your articularis genu. Again a question. And this is the only bursa which actually every time it is directly communicating with inside of the joint. It is directly in communication with inside of the joint, that you can see over here, with inside the joint. Suprapatellar bursa. These are your prepatellar bursa and these are your infrapatellar bursa. These prepatellar bursa and infrapatellar bursa may also get involved in few of the inflammations, which are known as bursitis. Prepatellar bursa, we call it as a housemaid's knee. We call it as a housemaid's knee. The housemaids who are sweeping the floors and also they try to bend all the time to do their household chores. So in that, the prepatellar bursa may get inflamed, known as prepatellar bursitis. This superficial infrapatellar bursa, it is known as a clergyman's knee. It is known as a clergyman's knee. So in clergymen or the priests who kneel down to offer their prayers, most of the time they don't bend so much forward. Therefore, it is the infrapatellar bursa which is involved. So the infrapatellar bursitis, that is known as a clergyman's knee, and the prepatellar bursitis is known as a housemaid's knee. The suprapatellar bursa is actually connected to the knee joint. Now, medially you have this pes and serenus. Medially you have this pes and serenus over here. And it's bursitis because you have the three tendons over here. If you recall those three tendons were actually, from anteriorly we have the sartorius, in middle we have the gracilis, behind we have the semitendinosus. Around these three tendons, obviously there are three tendons, so you have to have bursa. These three tendons are coming from all the three compartments of the thigh. So therefore, its bursitis is also not uncommon, mainly in the athletes. So mainly in the athletes who use a lot of their thigh muscles, pes and serenus, bursitis is common. Then behind you have what? Behind you have a semimembranosus tibial collateral ligament bursa. So this bursa, semimembranosus bursa, it is actually communicating anteriorly with the bursa which is around the medial head of gastrocnemius. So remember these names, these bursa. So medial head of gastrocnemius is also present anteriorly, and this medial head of gastrocnemius bursa, because see, whenever you are using the terms of any muscles and tendons, these tendons, they around them you have the bursa. So the bursa around the medial head of gastrocnemius, it may communicate with the joint, with the knee joint. And this semimembranosus bursa may communicate with the medial head of gastrocnemius bursa. So in a way, semimembranosus bursa may communicate with inside the joint cavity. Okay, last not the least, if there is any degeneration of the knee joint, there is increased synovial fluid formation. In those cases of increased synovial fluid formation, it may come posteriorly, because that is the space posteriorly, which is the popliteal fossa. So in a space posterior popliteal fossa, it may appear like a cyst known as the Baker cyst. Also, it is not uncommon to see. Okay, so Baker cyst is mainly due to degeneration of any situation, the knee joint, in which the knee joint tries to produce more of a popliteal, more of the synovial fluid that may enter into the popliteal fossa. That is known as our Baker cyst. So these are the few important bursas around the knee joint. And here we can see a figure showing you the Baker cyst. So you can see over here in this area, this is the area of the Baker cyst. This is on the left popliteal fossa, we can see a Baker cyst, a accumulation of the synovial fluid over here. So these were the bursas. Moving from here, we now come to the blood supply. So obviously the knee being a very major synovial joint. So obviously around this knee joint, we have various vessels, various arteries, which actually form a sort of anastomosis. So what are those vessels? From above, we have the femoral artery that is coming. But femoral artery, as it passes through the adductor hiatus, it becomes the popliteal artery. So basically it is a popliteal artery which is inside the popliteal fossa, but popliteal artery, as it goes down, it divides into anterior tibial and a posterior tibial artery. Now why I am writing these names, the reason for writing these names is that all of these arteries, femoral artery, popliteal artery, both the tibial arteries, and above also you have a circumflex femoral, they are going to form the anastomosis. Now what are the vessels which are involved in the anastomosis? From femoral artery, we have a descending genicular branch. Upper from the lateral circumflex femoral artery, we have a descending branch. From the popliteal artery, we have actually five genicular branches. Two going above, superior, superior. Two going below, inferior, inferior. One in the center, middle. Two going above, one going medially, one going laterally. Two going below, one going medially, one going laterally. And the middle one is middle genicular. So all these are the genicular. From these anterior posterior tibials, you mainly have few of the recurrent branches because these actually go down into the leg. So few of the recurrent branches, few would be posterior tibial would give off some of the fibular branches. So these are all the arteries which form the anastomosis around the knee joint right over here. So you can see superior, middle, superior medial genicular, middle genicular, inferior, and this one superior lateral, inferior lateral. So these are the five ones. This is the one coming descending genicular directly from the femoral artery. This is a descending branch of lateral circumflex femoral artery. This is from the posterior tibial and the anterior tibial. You have the recurrent arteries over here, and the posterior tibial also give off some of the circumflex fibular arteries. So the point over here is, all of these vessels are going to form anastomosis around the knee joint. Popliteal artery is present where? It is present posteriorly into the popliteal fossa. That is a different topic altogether. Okay, so these are all the anastomoses. Now, one question that may come is this middle genicular artery. It may pierce a ligament which is present posteriorly, which thickens the capsule posteriorly, which was a extension of the semimembranosus muscle. The name of the ligament was oblique. Very good. Oblique popliteal ligament. So, middle genicular artery pierces or perforates the oblique popliteal artery. Then it supplies the inside ligaments, mainly the cruciate ligaments. So cruciate ligaments now supply or blood supply mainly comes from the middle genicular artery, which is a branch of popliteal artery. Clear? Now moving from here, we have few movements which we need to consider. Now first of all, we should understand that knee joint is basically a hinge joint. Why? Because of the strong collateral ligaments, it mainly moves as a flexion and extension. But it is a modified, so we have some amount of rotation also. So what are the muscles which mainly cause the flexion? Flexion of the knee joint is when the leg is rotated towards the posterior side. So when the calf muscles, they try to touch the hamstring muscle. That is known as the flexion of the knee. Flexion of the knee is done by which muscles? It is done by the muscles which are present posteriorly, mainly the hamstrings. Mainly the hamstrings, which include the semimembranosus, semitendinosus, the biceps femoris, even the ischial part of the erector magnus. Apart from that, it will also be held by few muscles which are starting from the lower end of femoral condyle going posteriorly into the leg. That includes our gastrocnemius, and that may be supported even by the popliteus. Popliteus is a very important muscle. That was about flexion. Mainly flexion is done by these muscles. Then we have the movements of extension when you straight your knees. So when we straight our knees, the extension movement mainly done by the quadriceps femoris. Those four muscles of the anterior thigh compartment. So that was about the hinge joint. Now apart from hinge, it has a modified part. So it has few rotations also. So medial rotation and lateral rotation. Medial rotation would be done by the muscles which are present on the medial or posterior medial part of the tibia, which are coming from above, attaching to the medial part of tibia. So those are basically your semitendinosus, the semimembranosus. A little bit of gracilis may help, but basically it is semitendinosus and semimembranosus, the muscles of the posterior compartment of thigh. The lateral rotation is done by a very important muscle, that is your biceps femoris. Again, a muscle of the hamstring compartment, posterior compartment of thigh. Because it is attached to the fibula, so it will cause the lateral rotation. And because these are attached to the tibia, so they cause the medial rotation. So these are the main movements around the knee joint. So moving from movements, we have the locking and unlocking. So what is this locking and unlocking? See, there are various professions which you see, and as a person or the individual, he stands for a long time. For example, even in the medical profession, we have surgeries. Few surgeons who undertake surgeries which are very, very long continuously, and few other professions like the traffic police people. Various other professions, so where they have to stand for long. So when we stand for long, it is our leg muscles, which are voluntary muscles, so normally they should get fatigued, but still they keep on standing. Why? Because there is a locking of the knee joint. What is this locking? That is during standing position. That is when we stand, then these are the two condyles of femur, below you have the two condyles of tibia. So when we stand in an extension position, these condyles, they try to lock each other such that the knee becomes rigid. Knee becomes rigid, that is a femur, that is a thigh and leg becomes one compartment. So the muscles can be relaxed. Okay, so that locking is done by this rotation of a femur, that is the medial rotation of femur. So that is very important to understand that medial rotation of femur during the last stages of extension of knee, that causes locking. Now this is a position when the person is standing, the foot is on the ground. If the foot is not on the ground, then the opposite will happen to the tibia. That is, in the tibia there would be a lateral rotation of tibia that would also undergo locking. So locking in this second scenario will be when the foot is not on the ground, foot is hanging up, and then you do the hyperextension. So this is a locking point. This is mainly done by the muscles which are your quadriceps femoris, in that mainly by the vastus medialis. Now locked, mainly this upper medial rotation of femur occurs. So after the locking, now comes the part of unlocking. Unlocking means the opposite action. Please note it down, very very important. Unlocking of the knee joint is done by the muscle that is your popliteus. Popliteus was the muscle tendon whose tendon was inside the capsule, so it is the only intracapsular tendon of the whole lower limb. If you remember, then which was the intracapsular tendon present in the upper limb? Okay, try to write in the comment box which was the intracapsular tendon present in the upper limb. Okay, so this is the popliteus part which does the unlocking. So therefore the action of popliteus will be just the opposite, that is, it could cause a lateral rotation of femur or the medial rotation of tibia, because it is just the opposite of locking part. The nerve supplying the popliteus is basically our tibial nerve. Okay, so that was a locking unlocking. Moving from this locking unlocking, now I guess this was the basics of the whole knee joint that we have covered. Okay, so that was the whole basis of knee joint that we have covered, about its various movements, the ligaments, the injuries, few injuries. Okay, there are various other injuries also in the around the knee joint. It's just a brief idea. So I hope you like the video. If you liked it, then press the like button. Also try to comment any other videos, topics you want, write in the comment box. Share it and also subscribe the channel. The channel name is Anatomy Explained. That is all from my side, and bye bye. Stay safe. Thank you.